الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد. Continuing on in our treatise, Nawaqid al-Islam, we were in the first Naqid min Nawaqid al-Islam, where Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, اعلم أن نواقد الإسلام عشرة نواقد الأول شرك في عبادة الله تعالى قال الله تعالى إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء وقال تعالى إنه من يشرك بالله فقد حرم الله عليه الجنة ومأواه النار وما للظالمين من أنصار ومنه الذبح لغير الله كمن يذبح لجني أو للقبر. So, in the last lesson, we talked about Tawheed. We talked about Tawheed because Shirk negates Tawheed. And Shirk is the opposite of Tawheed. Tawheed meaning monotheism and Shirk meaning polytheism in its various forms. And since Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he began his treatise by talking about Shirk. And the reason he began talking about shirk, because it's one of the, as he says in one of his other treatises, he says, وَأَعْظَمَا نَاهَا أَنْهُ وَشِرْكُ وَأَعْظَمَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ التَّوْحِيدُ. He says that the greatest thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warned us against is shirk. And the greatest thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do is Tawheed, is worshiping Him subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So the most grievous sin that we could commit is shirk. So this is the importance, and this is why it is at the top of the Nawaqid al-Islam. So the Shaykh said, a shirk fi ibadatillahi ta'ala, you know, associating partners with Allah in worship. And then he gave the ayat, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ وَنْ يُشْرِكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرَ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. Verily Allah does not forgive that a person commits shirk with Him, but He forgives other than that for whomsoever He pleases. Meaning Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala forgives people for other sins, but if a person dies upon shirk or kufr, meaning shirk al-akbar, or kufr al-akbar, that which takes you out of the millah, takes you out of the fold of Islam, then they will be in the hellfire forever. And that is the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And that's what we believe as believers in Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is what the evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah shows us. And Allah the Almighty says, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنْصَارٍ. That Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says in another ayat, that Shaykh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab mentioned, verily, whoever associates a partner with Allah, then Allah has prohibited for him paradise, and his abode is the hellfire. And for the zalimeen, those wicked evildoers, those sinners, those transgressors, there is no one to help them or support them. They have no supporters on the Day of Judgment. No one will be able to help them and take away some of the fire and take away some of the blame for committing shirk. And as we mentioned in the previous darus, we mentioned that, of course, Tawheed, shirk negates Tawheed. And that Allah ordered us with Tawheed. Qala subhanahu wa ta'ala fi kitabi al-kareem, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I've not created mankind in the jinn except for the purpose of worshipping me. So that is our goal. That is our gaya. That is what, as Muslims, we are ordered to do. And that negates shirk. But shirk takes away from that. Whether it be the minor shirk, which negates, or it doesn't negate Tawheed in its totality, but it, if you want to say, contaminates, or it lessens a person's Tawheed. And the major shirk negates Tawheed. It negates a person's Tawheed. And it takes them out of the fold of Islam doing the major shirk. وَعِيَاذَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. And in relation to that, Sheikh Saleh bin Fawzan, Hafidhullah Ta'ala, he mentioned some very important benefits regarding that verse which orders us to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. He said, from this verse, we gain the benefit that it's an obligation to single out Allah alone for worship, meaning that Allah is the only one worthy of worship. And this is an order for all of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation, the jinn and the mankind. for jinn and mankind, as Allah said in the verse. Also, this verse shows us the hikmah, the wisdom behind the creation of mankind and jinn. That what? They were created to worship Allah alone, and that negates tawheed. And that negates shirk. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Khaliq, the creator of the heavens and earth, huwa mustahiq lil ibadah, he is the only one worthy of worship. All of this is known to us, but we can never hear it enough and we can never propagate it enough, because aktharhum la ya'lamun, most of the creation, they are unaware of this. This ayat also, as Shaykh Salim bin Fawzan, hafidh Allah ta'ala, mentions, ithbat al-hikmati fi af'alillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse also affirms the wisdom in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and earth, his actions. And by mentioning his actions, af'alillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala, it lets us know that what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divine names and attributes. He has divine names and attributes, and some of his attributes are fi'liya, meaning have to do with actions, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ar-Rahman ala arsh istawa, the most merciful, he rose above his throne. That means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rises. That's one of his attributes. Or nuzul, sifat nuzul, that's one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine attributes, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, yanzilu rabbuna tabaraka ta'ala kullu thulathil layl al-akhir, that Allah descends to the lowest depths, in the lowest depths of the last third of the night, to the lowest heaven, or to the lowest heaven. Naam. So from that we see that that's a part of tawheed. The relevance of that is that affirms for us that that's a part of tawheed. That that's a part of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's oneness, the monotheism, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. He's the creator of the heavens and earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divine names and attributes, which we worship Him by, and it gives us knowledge. Our knowledge about Allah comes from His divine names and attributes that are mentioned in the Quran and mentioned in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. And again, the opposite of that is what? Is shirk. Is doing that which opposes tawheed. And Allah orders this all throughout the Quran for tawheed and negating shirk. Qala subhanahu wa laqad ba'athna fi kulli ummatin rasulan an na'budu Allah wa ijtanibu tagut. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms for us what the messengers were sent with. Alayhim afdal salatu wa salam. Wa laqad ba'athna. And we sent to every nation a messenger to worship Allah. Wa'budu Allah in na'budu Allah. To worship Allah, which tenibu tagut, and stay away from those things, worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That right there affirms for us what true tawheed is and what true Islam is. That all the prophets and messengers, alayhim afdal salatu wasalam, were sent with the same message of tawheed and aqidah. Their aqidah didn't change. Their tawheed never changed. Their sharias changed. Their laws that they gave to their particular people, that Allah prescribed for them and their people, was different. The sharia's differed, but the creed never differed. Allah did not give people permission to commit shirk with Him in one time and tawheed in another. No, tawheed has always been the call. And that's why Allah said, وَلَكَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولٍ نَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ. And we sent to every nation a messenger to worship Allah, which تَنِبُوا تَغُوت, and that is, and to stay away from those things worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we mentioned in the previous lecture about Islam, al Islam istislam lillah bi tawhid wal inqiyad lahu bi ta'a wa khulus min shirk wa ahli, that the last part of the ta'rif or definition of Islam istislam lillah bi tawhid is to submit to Allah in pure monotheism, istislam lillah bi tawhid wal inqiyad lahu, in following His commands, wa inqiyad lahu wa khulus min shirk wa ahli, and avoiding shirk and the people of shirk. And how do we get these definitions? Do the scholars come up with these definitions for Islam and tawheed? Because many people, they'll define Islam as submitting to God, or they'll define Islam as peace. Well, those things are involved in the meaning. But how do we get these ta'rifat and these definitions? They come from the Sharia, they come from the Quran, and they come from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Allah Himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, let us know that in a statement which contains an affirmation and negation, nafi wal ithbat, that Allah affirmed wa'budullah. He said in na'budullah, he said in worship Allah. That's an order, that's an affirmation, which tanibu tagut, and he negated all the false worship and stay away from tagut. And that's what is implicit in the definition of Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says fi kitabi al-kareem wa qawluhu وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala says, and your Lord has commanded you to worship none except Him, and to the parents be righteous or obedient. بِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. You know, follow their orders. Be kind and gentle and obedient to them. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala in this verse, what did He say? He ordered us. وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ, and your Lord ordered you, أَلَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ, and to not worship. So first, Allah here negates worship. But what does He negate? He negates false worship, which is shirk. أَلَا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ, except Him. Except Him. And in the Arabic language, this has a very powerful meaning in the construct of the grammar, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses iya, that's why we say in Surah Al-Fatiha, iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een. Allah says this because that's an emphasis that's making ta'keed that we only worship Allah. There's no compromise in that. There's no compromise with shirk. We cannot commit shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. And there's other ways that you could say it in the Arabic language, but the meaning would not be as powerful and potent as the way Allah the Almighty said it. Illa iyyahu, iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. You know, it's You alone we worship, and it's You alone we seek help from. So that's affirming for us, affirming tawheed, negating shirk. Qala subhanahu wa'budu Allah wa la tushriku bi shay'in, and worship Allah and do not associate partners with Him. So all through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, Qul ta'alu atlu ma harama rabbukum alaykum ala tushriku bihi shay'in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, come and let me, He ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qul, say, come and let me tell you about what your Lord has prohibited you from, and that it is to not worship Him, to not associate partners with Him. Ala tushriku bihi shay'in, do not associate any partners with Allah. So there, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also commanding us, advising us, giving us the foundation of our religion, which is tawheed, and which is the call of the anbiya, of the prophets, alayhim afdal salatu wa salam. And what? And negating shirk, and negating worshiping other than Allah. So even if, regardless of whether it's the prophets, alayhim afdal salatu wa salam, whether it be Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Jesus sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Moses sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Isa alayhi salatu wa salam, or any of the prophets, or up to Adam alayhi salatu wa salam, it's negated and it's not accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushrika bihi wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. Verily Allah doesn't forgive that you associate partners with Him, but He forgives other than that for whomsoever He subhanahu wa ta'ala pleases. So Allah negates it regardless of whether it's a rock, a tree, or anything that you seek blessings and you pray, you supplicate to. Allah doesn't accept it. Even the angels, as close as they are, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't accept it. It's shirk. So moving on, the types of shirk. Shirk, as we've spoken in depth about tawheed, and in also worship, the concept of worship, shirk can be defined as supplicating or worshiping something else with or besides Allah, regardless of whether it is a rock, a tree, a prophet, or an angel. Some scholars classify shirk or polytheism into three types: shirk al-akbar, shirk al-asgar, wa shirk al-khafi. But the most common classification that's used by many of the scholars is shirk al-akbar wa shirk al-asgar. Shirk al-akbar is the major polytheism, which encompasses those actions, sayings, or beliefs which take a person out of Islam. And the consequences of committing major shirk are that a person who dies in this state will be in the hellfire eternally and is forbidden from entering paradise. And that was what the shahid of the verse with Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab mentioned, the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that that the person who dies upon the major shirk, inna Allah la yaghfiru an yushraka bihi wa yaghfiru ma duna dhalika liman yasha. Allah doesn't forgive the major shirk. But he forgives other than that for whomsoever he pleases. And then in the other verse where the Shaykh, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنصَارٍ. And for the ظَالِمِينَ, those wrongdoers, those oppressive sinners, there's no one's going to help them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits paradise for the one who dies upon that. And so the reason the punishment is so severe for the major shirk is because shirk negates the purpose of creation, as we mentioned, as the wisdom of the Creator. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونِ. I have not created mankind and jinn except for the purpose of worshipping me. By committing shirk, one negates monotheism. As we mentioned, the major shirk negates monotheism in totality. Another consequence of major shirk is that it nullifies all of a person's good deeds. So the major shirk, it also negates all of a person's good deeds. It negates all their good deeds, and it negates their monotheism. So what do you have if you don't have tawheed and you don't have good deeds? What's left? Another consequence of major shirk is that it nullifies all of a person's good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and if they commit shirk, then their deeds will be nullified. Finally, the major shirk removes the sanctity of a Muslim with regards to his or her life, property, and social relations, because then a person is no longer considered Muslim. They've lost that izzah, that honor of being a believer in Allah. It's not a believer in this race, a believer in this color, a believer in this type of nationalism, or this, but it's a believer in Allah. That brotherhood of Islam, it's broken when a person commits the major shirk and they leave Islam and they leave Tawheed. وَعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ مِنْ ذَلِكَ. And the next time we talk, we'll continue on in shirk, and we'll hopefully finish this Naqid min Nawaqid al-Islam, which is the first one. So the next time we'll finish and we'll talk about the minor shirk and the difference between the major and the minor shirk, and then we'll continue on into the second Naqid min Nawaqid al-Islam. And I ask Allah the Almighty to accept our good and forgive our evil. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ.